Hello, welcome to Spiritual Spectrum. My name is James Terrell, and Terry Kruger and I will be your hosts on the show. In this new edition of Spiritual Spectrum, we're going to be using somewhat of a new format and tackling some issues that may become more controversial. We hope that you'll enjoy this. I'm going to ask each of the guests today to introduce themselves. We're going to be talking about vegetarianism and spirituality. Well, Terry, why don't you go ahead?
I'm not a guest, James.
Oh, come on.
Yeah, we're going to talk with Sarva. Sarva, why don't you introduce yourself to
her? I'm Sarva Drik from the Hare Krishna temple.
So which side are you on then? Are you, you know?
I'm definitely on the vegetarian.
Definitely on the vegetarian.
And Hal?
I'm Hal Katzen. I am definitely not on the vegetarian side.
Okay.
I'm Bill Scheeley from Evangel Baptist Church, and I'm ready to go either way.
So you're a potential convert, eh, Bill?
I'm a potential convert, that's right.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Sure.
Well, let's maybe get things started off with, I'd like to hear what Sarva has to say about why we should eat vegetables and not meat.
It's a big topic. First thing that should be considered is that an animal is not an inanimate object. Of course, now there's a vegetable, but that's another point that we can bring up later in the discussion. For an animal, specifically cows and sheep and pigs, are very sensitive creatures, and we have no right to impose our will on them, to slaughter them in a very merciless way, and to use their flesh to maintain our own flesh. And we can maintain our life very simply by eating vegetables. First, I'm a lacto-vegetarian. There's many different varieties of vegetarians, lacto, ovo, lacto, and vegan. Lacto-ovo is a person who takes all varieties of dairy products. Lacto-vegetarian is someone who uses milk products and vegetables. And the vegan is someone who uses only products from the vegetable kingdom.
So would an ovo, is that eggs?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Eggs and milk and cheese, yogurt, that kind of thing.
And you personally don't eat eggs?
No.
Either, is that correct?
Eggs.
Okay.
But the main point is that I personally feel, and it's the feeling of our spiritual tradition, that a human being doesn't have the right to cut short an animal's life to maintain our life, when we can maintain ourselves very simply on simple foodstuffs.
What's the normal lifespan of a cow, Hal? Do they have a right to live 10 years?
No, I don't recognize cow rights in the way that I recognize human rights. My belief is that God has created this planet the way it is with a purpose in mind, and that there are varying levels and degrees of life endowment. They're easy to recognize. You might talk about rocks and so forth and dirt as having a zero life endowment. They don't procreate or have a life force like that. Then it goes up through amoebas and plants and animals. You start to get into animals, and then you have a degree of mind endowment, obviously, I think. And then with human beings, in my belief system, draw a distinction. Human beings have a spirit endowment, that this is a gift from God that is different and added on to the mind endowment that we have in common with other animals. I believe if God really doesn't want animals to suffer, he's got a very peculiar way of demonstrating that with this planet. Animals get eaten alive all over this world, have for millions of years, and seems like it's going to continue. If God demonstrates a different pattern and has the, as we say, the lamb lying down with the lion, I'll probably become a vegetarian. That would be a good indication to me that God doesn't want flesh eaten, and that it's somehow distressing to God to have that happen. But I don't think there's any indication that God cares that animals get eaten alive. And I don't see why the bear should get a nice piece of sushi and not me.
But isn't that why we have to look to understand what God wants to look at the Scripture? The Scripture means what God has told us about human behavior. And to say that because the animals are eating each other, it's all right for man to do that. But if we recognize man as having a higher mindset, a higher intelligence, he should also be able to act like a man and not act like an animal and eat his fellow animals.
What do you think, Hal?
The reference to scripture here is an important one. We reference different scriptures. I have been...
Well, I use scripture, yeah. You know, the Bhagavad Gita, the Torah, the Quran, the
right.
Bible.
My belief systems concerning various aspects of God giving mind endowment and spirit endowment and what all that means comes from a book called the Urantia book, which I've been reading for 10 years now. And I find for myself that the belief systems that I've acquired from that text fall in line very well with what I observe in the world to be, how should I say, the better indications of what is upsetting and distressing to God. I look at human potentials to avoid suffering and hardship, and I look at the way human beings can benefit from suffering and hardship and, you know, the evolution out of that to a life that has less suffering. I don't see that kind of potential for animals. I don't think it really exists, and I think that there's a reason for that. It's not important.
What about a human being, say he's retarded, who has really not much more consciousness than a human being? Is it all right to eat him?
Do I believe so?
Yeah.
No, not unless maybe...
But he has no more intellectual capacity or mental capacity than an animal, but he has a human form.
Jump in there, Bill.
He's thinking of a recipe. He's thinking of a recipe for retarded human.
Yeah. I say, well, Bill, what's your view on all this? You know, how do you stand?
Well, you see, as a typical American Baptist, I take a middle of a road kind of view. I do represent mainstream Protestantism, and we in the mainstream really do have a rather ambivalent view of the world, I guess.
By ambivalent, do you mean you don't have any feelings of guilt when you eat a hamburger?
No. The fact is that we are squarely positioned right in the middle, and so let me just tell you where I am on this. I feel that basically most Christians are not going to be going to a vegetarian concept from the same basis of spiritual thought as Sarva would, because our particular scriptures would not have anything against killing. I also agree with Hal.
Doesn't the Bible say thou shalt not kill?
I talked to a rabbi about that recently, and was very interested to discover that in the Hebrew, that it really doesn't say thou shalt not kill. It really says thou shalt not murder.
Thou shalt not do murder.
Uh-huh. And so that's really, so I feel that if your religion is, you know, attempting to tell us that our scriptures say thou shalt not kill, you're really misinterpreting that, because it's really a matter of murder.
In Isaiah it says that, in the Bible in Isaiah, it says that one who slays an ox is as if he had slain a man.
Well, but there are,
That's because it's job, though. It's not.
Yeah, but whether you say murder,
us.
Say I won't rob you. I'll steal from you, because I'm stealing and not robbing. It's all right. So if you get caught up in word jugglery, well, I'm not murdering. I'm killing. I'm murdering.
But when
doesn't make it any different.
But when
you're taking
when
a person's
you really
life,
look at the Old Testament, you look at the Old Testament. There has not been any kind of penalty against, for example, execution or war. All of those things are, at least in the Old Testament, are considered to be perfectly within the framework of morality. The big problem is at the point of murder rather than killing. I'd also go along with what Hal says, is that the fate of most animals really is to die a violent life.
And
a violent death, yeah. And so most animals do end up very violently dying.
So we should sort of help them out by killing them.
No. All I'm saying is that human beings are not really necessarily. Well, it may be, in fact, that human beings might kill even a little more humanely than other animals will, But
it's
the fact is,
when
most
you consider
animals don't.
The way that veal, for instance, is raised in America, mm-hmm. Milk-fed veal is mm-hmm. usually corralled in a space in the dark. You know, these baby calves, where they can't move probably more than 5 or 6 inches in any direction, and they live in their own excrement, and I'm not sure how long it is, a matter of 4 months, something like that, maybe, before they're slaughtered. When we look at the way, for instance, chickens are kept in order to produce protein for human beings, this doesn't involve killing, I suppose, but there certainly seems to be some pretty critical issues around cruelty to animals in the way that we, you know, harvest them for our own situation. I think that one of the issues that I'd like to introduce at this point is, do we, you know, see ourselves as stewards of the world?
Can I comment on that? In other words, if you say, it's just a question of how we kill them. Isn't killing someone the most cruel thing you can do? It's like if I say to you, say you own a bank or you own a jewelry store, I'm going to rob you, but I'm going to do it like a gentleman. Does that make it all right? So you can't say that we killed
them.
Right. I've killed you. I've killed you humanely. I've killed you painlessly. But still, I've killed. I've taken your life.
But the
just because you do it nicely doesn't make it right.
But there really would be a degree of harm that we do each other, so that in some ways, if I'm going to be robbed, I would rather be robbed in a humane way than in an inhumane way.
But if you give an animal a choice, whether it wants to be killed or whether it doesn't want to be killed, and clearly an animal can make that choice. He's not an inanimate robot.
How do they make that
choice? If you run after it with a knife, it's going to run away from you.
Well, now choice is a very value-laden word.
Amen.
The whole concept of free will is something that's been debated for centuries. And I think that this really needs to be brought up when you say an animal has a choice. I take issue with that. I think there's a real difference between...
Not a choice like a human being.
Exactly.
Right. But still he has a choice.
Well, no. Animals have instincts. We have instincts. Mm-hmm. And animals have instincts. And they have mind characteristics and endowments that enable them to learn and so forth. But in terms of making a real free will choice...
A rational choice.
Well, rational, perhaps, if it might be something you could throw in there, but I would say particularly free will. I don't recognize animals as having what you might call unique personalities. They have minds.
You've seen one rabbit, you've seen.
In a sense that there will be varying degrees of characteristic among animals.
Well,
we see that just because of each rabbit is a little different. Their mind endowment is a little different, and that's not hard to tell. I mean, we breed dogs and so forth, the show dogs and horses, for their intelligence. We recognize intelligence, but that doesn't mean these animals make choices in the ways that human beings do in terms of altruism. And you know, when have you ever seen a dog do something for all dog kind? You know what I mean?
Let me ask you something. When you go to pick up a pot from the stove and the handle's hot, and is that a choice? Is pain at the level of conscious choice?
Well, the pain can be very much a matter of choice for human beings. This is well demonstrated by techniques like hypnosis and so forth. And just, you know, people get their wisdom teeth out with hypnosis. And that involves their willingness to subject themselves to a state of consciousness where there is not
pain. Is ignored.
Where pain is ignored. The receptors just don't quite seem to fire in the same way.
Well, I think Sarva is saying that, you know, if you give an animal a choice, he's going to move away from the painful situation
opportunity is probably a better word.
Is it all right to inflict pain on a sentient being? If you kill a cow or a pig, it'll scream in pain. Is that all right? Is what I'm really asking.
Pain is a criterion. Is I think a really a terrible criterion. I mean, sometimes we inflict physical pain on human beings, our children, for very good reasons, you know, for their own good. And I don't mean beating kids or something. I mean sometimes in a medical emergency.
No, you can't have the Visa card.
No, right, you can't have the Visa card. You know, you're out in the woods and someone breaks their legs and you got to set it. You got to pull on it and it hurts. It's painful.
But what does that have to do with slaughtering an animal?
Well,
you're trying to help the person. If you don't set his leg, he'll die.
Exactly.
Well, but if you're slaughtering an animal unnecessarily, I don't see the relationship between helping someone with a broken leg.
I'd like to jump in on Sarva's side here for a moment, because I think that it is true that animals certainly do have pain, and animals certainly do have at least maybe not a conscious decision-making kind of process, but they do have a will to live. So they have an innate concern for their own well-being. And I think that's something that we as Christians need to really address in a more forthright way than we've done in the past. I think that we have for too long taken for granted that it's all right to raise the calves for the veal.
Well, let me ask you a question as a Christian. Then, you believe God is essentially all-powerful? Not that God can create round squares or God can do the impossible, but...
Why not?
Sure, God's all-powerful, benevolent.
If he's all-powerful,
well,
he can do it.
I'll allow that for the moment, as the judges say. Well,
They say he can make a mountain that's too heavy to lift.
Sure.
But then he can lift it.
Well, that's just a question. Do you believe, as a Christian, that it was somehow impossible for God to create a world where the economy of the plants and animals was such that sentient animals wouldn't be eaten by each other and only the vegetable life would be eaten by the animals? Was that impossible for God to do?
Oh, I think God could do whatever he wanted to.
So that is possible.
Sure.
So God chose not to create a world like that.
Okay, but what you're assuming, though, is that we have the ability, any one of us have the ability to know what the mind of God is. Then I don't think that we know what the mind of God is. I think we have to just keep struggling with that. And so I think that you're assuming that because certain people have behaved in certain ways for a long period of time that they necessarily know the mind of God because of that.
No, I assume like yourself that God could have created a world where animals weren't eating each other, and that he chose not to, and that there's a purpose in that. And that there's a lesson for human beings in particular, which is that...
That's very speculative.
Well, sure it is, but speculating on...
There's no speculation allowed on the show, Hal. Sorry.
It's all theological speculation.
But I think you're all focusing at the wrong level here. Aren't we really talking about killing living cells, regardless of the organism that they start out in? Whether they're animal or plant, you're killing them to survive.
So
these
what?
Cells. I'm saying vegetarians don't have a moral right to say you're killing animals is cruel and morally bankrupt when they're killing plant cells to survive. What's the difference?
The difference is, according to, at least from our perspective, in the Upanishads. You're familiar with the Upanishads? In the Upanishads.
Well, I haven't read a small fraction of them then translated.
Well, there's 108 Upanishads. The first Upanishad is called the Isha Upanishad. And there it's stated, Isha Vasyam Idam Sarvam Jatkincha Jagatyam Jagat. Tena chak tena bunjita magridha kasya svidhanam.
You've all got that out there.
There
will be a test afterwards.
That means that everything animate and inanimate within the universe is controlled and owned by God. It's his property.
Right.
Therefore, it's tena chak tena bunjita, and he's setting aside a quota for the maintenance of every species of life. For example, if a tiger kills me and eats me, he hasn't stepped outside of his God-given quota of foodstuffs. I'm food for a tiger. A cow is food for a tiger.
Oh, that's bad news.
Okay? But if I kill that same tiger, then I've transgressed my quota that's set aside by God.
I mean, he can have you, but you can't have him?
Right.
Ooh, okay? Unfair.
But as you say, every living being, and it's like the Bhagavatam says, jivo jivasya jivanam, which means that every living being is maintaining itself at the expense of another living being. That's a given. But we step outside the laws of God when we take those foodstuffs. They're not set aside for a particular species of life.
So you have some sort of guide that says what foodstuffs are set aside for human beings then.
And I think every spiritual tradition does. Like I know the Bible does. I'm not familiar so much with the Torah or the Quran. But I know that there's very strict dietary laws that are followed in Judaism, for example. And also Christianity. Many of the early Christians were also vegetarians. Jesus' brother was a vegetarian. Matthew was a vegetarian. And because they say James was a vegetarian, it's also speculated that Jesus was also a vegetarian, being a member of the Essene community.
Wasn't he a fisherman, though?
There's a lot of... some people say that when they talk about fish or ichthus, it meant Christ the Anointed One, and it was used in a symbolical...
Well, supposedly the miracle of the loaves and fishes, he fed a whole lot of people fish. Mm-hmm. So if he was feeding them fish, he obviously didn't care that they ate it. So I would assume he ate fish too.
The question that I'm addressing is whether he ate it himself.
I think if he would create fish for others to eat, that he saw no problem with
it. But that's not rational. In other words,
sure
you say, well, God created arsenic, or Jesus created arsenic, if you accept that he's God, so he should eat arsenic.
No, he fed loaves and fishes to people, not arsenic.
People say that when they talk about fish, that they're talking about symbology of the blessings, distributing the blessings of God.
I never heard anyone say that, have you?
There's a thing, it's interesting.
I could read that.
This is a book
by
Keith
Akers. While you find that, Bill, could you relate to us where it says in the Bible about man being able to use all the plants and animals on the earth?
Well, I believe it's the book of Acts where Peter is very, very hungry, and he's on the roof of a house, and he has this vision of a big sheet coming down, and in the sheet are all sorts of animals of the whole earth. And a voice tells him to take and eat, and he says, Lord, I can not eat anything that is unclean. And the voice says, do not call anything that I have made unclean. So from a Christian standpoint, anything in the earth, you know, whether it be shellfish or any of the taboo foods of the Jewish people and so forth, anything would theoretically then be not unclean. And I think that to some extent we as Christians it's always a constant struggle between that which is holy and that which is profane. But I think that we tend to try to not separate the holy from the profane too much. So that even as we celebrate the Lord's Supper, we are not simply celebrating a holy meal, but this is also something which could be in conjunction with an everyday kind of meal, as indeed we believe the early communion services were. They were simply meals that the disciples or the early church would have, and at that time they would remember Christ. So I think we have very deeply within our own tradition the idea that anything on the face of the earth can be eaten. But I do also think that from the standpoint of a continuing revelation, that we need to take seriously the polarity of differing views that we have in our world today. And I think we need to look at some of these other things. For example, you look at Seventh-day Adventists, and I understand that the people who are complete vegetarians within that group do, in fact, live longer lives than those who are not vegetarians. So if we take a view that the human personality is both body and spirit, that we should therefore take care of both our spiritual life as well as our physical body, that this is a good thing to continue living, then I think that perhaps the vegetarianism should be taken with some seriousness.
Okay. Sarva, did you find the quote you were looking for?
It says here, a bishop of the early church wrote as his own epita of the fish symbolically saying, quote, faith hath provided as my food a fish of exceeding great size and perfect, which a holy virgin drew with her hands from a fountain. And also in the second century, he wrote similarly, quote, we little fish, after the image of our ichthus, Jesus Christ, are born in the water. And Jesus Christ is not a fish. He's referring in a symbolic way. Clearly, the use of the term fish is symbolic, not literal, in these cases. It is quite likely that such symbolism has managed to get into the Gospels, and that all of the fish stories, which we find there are not even intended to be taken literally, rather are intended symbolically. And he goes on giving.
I believe my father's fish stories. Yes,
you know, I think I'd like to declare myself in this debate here. I'm a strict vegetarian, and I am practice that for spiritual reasons. I think, though, that if we look at our role as human beings, as stewards of this creation, and I think we would all agree that we have some role of stewardship here. Is that accurate? Would you say so, Hal?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And I see Sarva nodding his head. I think it would be useful for us to look at how many people end up eating beefsteak and how many people end up starving because of the amount of grazing land and grain that it takes to produce
a pound
of beef. Mm-hmm. And I don't necessarily request that everyone take the same kind of spiritual look at this that perhaps Sarva and I might, since we both are coming from somewhat of a yogic tradition. But let's look at how many people don't eat in order for people to eat beefsteak.
Yeah, I think we ought to clear the smoke. You're right, because I think that whole line of reasoning is an incredible smoke screen to try to justify vegetarianism. The problem is not that we need to eat more vegetables because people are starving to death. That's because of the way human beings live amongst themselves and relate to each other. There is not infinite potential on this planet for an infinite number of human beings to live on it at once. At some point in time, hopefully, we will come to reckon with the facts of our procreative endowments and deal with them in a healthy way. And, to say that we need to just absolutely maximize the population on this earth so that, you know, by making everyone vegetarian, I think is really sort of a silly notion. And the whole idea that if we just started, you know, eating less beef, the people in Bangladesh are going to have more food in their stomachs is nonsense. Getting food to Bangladesh is not a problem. The problem is people don't have enough of the desire to get them food. We really don't have that kind of scarcity, I don't think. It's more that we have, are turning Central America into cash crop agriculture for our own use. We do all kinds of things to just be selfish and wasteful.
Are you familiar with one of the main cash crops in the rainforest?
Beef.
Mm.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Is that all right, to cut down the forests and rape the land to
no,
make
absolutely,
beef for McDonald's?
It's not all right, but it is, I think, a very poor point of logic to try and say, therefore, we shouldn't be eating meat. No, the problem is that we're destroying our planet. We're destroying rainforest. Mm-hmm. We're destroying the whole eco-environment that we live in. That's serious, and that really, you know, demands attention. And when we kill animals to plant or animals, I think we're really denying our stewardship.
What if it were the other way around all of a sudden, and instead of tearing down the rainforest to raise cattle, we were tearing down the rainforest to raise broccoli? Instead of Burger Kings on every other corner in metropolitan areas, there were vegetarian restaurants, and the world economy was geared towards vegetarianism.
See, that's where the fallacy of Hal's argument comes up, is that on an acre of land, you can raise 16 times as much food from in the vegetarian category as you can in the meat category. So even though he's saying that if someone stops eating meat in America, you're not going to be putting food in someone's stomach in Bangladesh, that may be true due to our economic situation. However, if there was a vegetarian mindset where people are more interested in that, are going to live in that way, there is more food available on a smaller amount of land, and that mm-hmm. It's not a matter of opinion, that's a fact.
Yes, it is a fact, absolutely. We could maximize
why not
the population on the world if we all ate vegetarian. But so what? Is that the goal? Put on as many people on this planet as we can and feed them all vegetarian diets?
Well, we're not feeding all the people that are here now.
Exactly. So that's what I'm saying. It's a moot point to try and say the problem is that we don't have a vegetarian diet. That's not the problem. The problem is we as cultures don't care about all the starving people, and we're not mature enough to regulate our own procreation in a responsible way.
Well, then you're saying that God can't supply for as many people that are here? There's hundreds and thousands of wasted acres of land that could be used to raise food. Instead, we build cities on them, and we build, you know, water slides, and we build Disneylands and things for our pleasure, instead of raising food to maintain ourselves. It's not that God can't provide, but when human society denies the laws of God and transgresses the laws of God, especially in terms of our diet, then there's a restriction also.
You know, I think that we're getting into another kind of misconception here, too. I think it's very common these days. It's this new diet, that new diet. Everybody in the world needs to eat this one diet.
Well, vegetarianism isn't a new diet.
No, it's not new, but
it's thousands and thousands of years old.
What's new is the attitude that everyone needs to eat a similar kind of diet. What are we going to do? Ship all kinds of vegetables and grains up to the Eskimos so they can be all spiritual like us? In that part of the world, they need to eat blubber and fish. And the fact is, they're very healthy. They don't have heart attack because in that environment, God has provided balance for them. The cold water fish, the fish oils in cold water fish, break down the cholesterol that they need to eat in order to, you know,
if they don't die from mercury poisoning.
If they don't die from mercury.
But see, that's another misconception, is that spirituality is intrinsically linked to vegetarianism. It's not.
It's not, is it?
Vegetarianism is a foundation for spirituality. You can't say I'm a very spiritual person if you're going out and murdering people or slaughtering animals or robbing banks or raping people. It falls in a category of an immoral act.
No, you can't say that. I can.
I'm saying that. I'm saying that. Yeah. And you can accept it. It's up to you to accept or not. All I'm saying is that one isn't innately spiritual if he's a vegetarian. A pigeon's a vegetarian. He's not becoming spiritually enlightened by his diet. But I definitely think it's a fact that if one isn't a vegetarian, it would be very difficult for him to understand what is spirit. Because while you talk about an animal not having a mind, I think something we haven't touched on is whether it has a soul or not. And whether I, as one soul, have a right to inflict pain and suffering on another soul and eat his flesh.
Oh, I wouldn't suggest it. That you believe that animals have souls, I suggest you absolutely don't eat those animals because you believe they have souls.
But do they? It's not a question of belief. Do they? And like, if I believe in gravity, doesn't mean that gravity exists. But if I don't believe in it, like,
it exists whether you believe in it or not.
But there's a fact of life.
Yeah, but
does it have a soul or does it not?
But we disagree.
If it does, shouldn't we respect it? That animal's right to exist.
If it does, but we choose our beliefs. There's nothing that forces you to believe that
In other words, you're saying is there's no absolute truth.
I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying that in our search for the absolute truth, we end up with different beliefs, contrary beliefs.
But what is there an absolute truth?
I think so, sure.
Okay, so what does, in that context...
It's just we're not privy to it.
Is there such a thing?
It can't be proven. Which way are you leaning at the present time?
Well, I don't know. I'd like to get to another area of all of this, and that is that I think that we as human beings are certainly related to one another. Someone has written recently that none of us on the face of the earth could be any further related than a 50th cousin. And I mean, of whatever color or race we are all, that is the furthest reach that any of us can be. And those of us here are probably something like a 20th cousin or something. And so if we take those of us of a more liberal or middle of the road perspective of mainline Christianity, would say most of us, or a good many of us, would believe in evolution. So if we believe in evolution, truly believe in evolution, then it seems to me we have to say, not only am I related to all of you, but I may even be a 100th relation to my cats. I mean, you know, I am organically, or whatever one would say, but physically in some way related to every other piece of life here on the earth. So from that standpoint, I think it demands that I have some kind of respect for all kinds of life. Now, that doesn't mean I treat every bit of life equally. I don't treat a germ that is going to infect my body at the time that I'm having an operation with the same kind of respect that I do my cat. But it does mean that I have some kind of respect for for all of animal life and plant life too. We know that at some point there are some things that are part animal and plant, like the corals, I think, are a combination of that.
A lot of primitive borderline life forms.
So really, we could say that we are also related to plants and so forth. So I think that we as Christians have really been willy-nilly on all of this for too long. We have just sloughed off the claims of Eastern religions, and we've just said, oh, that is just too silly, that is just too ridiculous, too far out for me to even consider.
Well, Cousin James,
I just think we have to consider.
Cousin James, I want to ask you, what do you think of the idea of animals having souls? Can we draw a line somewhere there that's reasonable as a criteria for respecting animal life?
Well, I think it's important that we do how are we going to demonstrate whether they have a soul or not? It's somewhat difficult to prove that the human being has a soul.
It's an easy thing, actually.
Yeah,
what's the criteria for
like here's a wooden table. There's wood here. It's the same chemical constituents as
a plastic
tree. Okay, well, for the sake of argument, we'll say it's wood. Here, this one's wood.
Yeah.
My chair is wood.
Okay.
So here's wood. It's the same cellulose. It's the same cells as we find in a tree growing outside.
Okay.
We can take a sliver of this wood, plant it in the ground, water it, give it sun, give it love and attention, fertilize it.
Grow a chair?
It'll never grow.
Oh.
That's what I'm saying. It'll never grow because there's something missing in this wood than there is in the other wood.
Okay.
It's growing outside. And we say that's the soul. Wherever you find life, we can say there's a soul. Whether it's in a bacteria or whether it's in a human being, still there's a soul, there's a life force present within that.
Well, you know,
not to say they're all the same. That you respect a bacteria as you would a human life. Well, I killed bacteria, I can kill a man like that. It's not the same.
I think consciousness,
the soul is there.
Consciousness and life and soul might, you know, get a little, you know, blurred in this. And it doesn't have to have a soul for me to not want to kill it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you were to
if it doesn't have a soul, what are you killing?
What are you killing?
A chicken.
What is a chicken?
A chicken is fried.
My question would be, how many people would eat the hamburger if they had to chop the cow's head off and you know, gut it and you know, grind up the muscles themselves? How many people's sensibilities, including yours, since you're sort of a proponent for this, are of the constitution that this would be an acceptable way to behave weakly, okay, to sustain my life? Not so for me. I know, all right, that it's possible for me to sustain my life without physically killing at least another animal. I would also argue that it may be possible to do so without killing another vegetable, but I'm not evolved enough at the point to live off the vibrational nutrition.
Well, some vegetables come without killing, like an apple, a fruit comes from a tree. The grains come from the wheat after the plant is dead. There's certain things that are karma-free, or not, don't have any adverse reaction.
Interesting, rather than like a broccoli that you sort of have to pick.
Another thing, as he was calling Brother James, also St. Francis of Assisi, a great proponent of ahimsa and nonviolence, would address the animals as brother cow or sister bird, you know, cousin rain. He would have that. He had that vision as a saintly person. He had that vision that we are intrinsically linked with the other creatures of this planet.
Yes, an interesting thing around that too was that Francis, one of the stories that's told about him was that there was a wolf that was terrorizing the village that he lived in, and he went and he talked to the wolf and asked him not to terrorize the village and kill people, and he would see that he was fed. The villagers would feed him. And this, according to legend, did happen, and the wolf is now buried, it is said, in the walls of a church.
Isn't legend convenient?
That's where the legend...
You can just make any point you
well,
want
but
with
no,
a good
but,
legend.
The thing about that, Hal, is the fact that the thing that I find interesting is that there was a man who had this empathy with animals. Now, I don't have much empathy with animals. The only animals I have any empathy with are my cats.
Would you eat your cat?
I would not eat my cats. No, I wouldn't.
Or if your life depended on it?
No.
You would starve before you ate your cat.
I would starve before I would eat my cats.
You know, this is a good point that you bring up.
Because I don't know what they taste like.
You know, why do human beings have empathy towards the animals? I think since we're all, in our own ways, I believe, playing armchair theologist, and what does, you know, how has God set it up? I'd like to take a little crack at armchair psychologist. My own experience of observation is that the reason people attach themselves to beliefs about animals, and I think you also find it with babies, is because people who have trouble with forgiveness, forgiving adult human beings with free will who do bad things, people have a lot of love in their hearts, but whose spirits are weak in the area of forgiveness, need to direct this love somewhere, and they attach themselves to beliefs that will enable the love to be released. And I believe that the love gets channeled towards the blameless. You know, you ever blame a cow for something, or the tiger? You know, it's very difficult, or a baby. You know, and people's hearts will go out and attach themselves to a belief system that enables the love to flow because it's been blocked up by not being able to forgive human beings.
Why does it have to be a belief system to love another being? It's like I love my children.
Like I say,
I love my children, but I don't think that has anything to do with the belief system. I love them. Yeah. I don't think I have any guilt, some mysterious guilt in my consciousness that makes me do that. I love my children because they're my children. I love my wife because she's my wife.
Yeah.
So why not be able to love an animal for its own intrinsic worth? Why have to try and explain your love away by saying, well, I was guilty about something, I did something bad, and if I love this animal, it'll make it right. I don't think that's correct.
This is real interesting. This brings up an argument that I've advanced towards little kids on at least two or three occasions in my life when I watched them picking bugs apart, you know, like pulling the wings off of the bugs and like that, which is something that we as younger human beings seem
to have a great pleasure
kind
in
of
doing.
Penchant to, or curiosity, I don't know. I asked them, gee, can you put them back on? And that is sort of the approach that I take towards life. You know, can I fix this? If I whack the cow's head off, can I, you know, put it back on? Can I reconstruct those cells whose, you know, are created with such immaculate, I mean, it's
no
a miracle.
No better than when you chop that broccoli off. You're going to put the broccoli back on?
Broccoli plant's still alive after you take the broccoli.
As a matter of fact, it produces broccoli way
more
into the winter. I might still have broccoli in my garden.
Some plants are harvested and you eat them all. I mean,
yeah, so like a carrot.
Yeah,
you pull
I mean, you pull your scallion out. Hey, it's gone. That's it. No more.
That's why it's a given. Jivo jivasya jivanam. That every living being has to live at the expense of another being. Therefore, if a person is actually religious, he should follow the instructions of God and eat only those things that are set aside as his quota. And then he's not transgressing the laws of God. He's living within the given realm of having to live.
Right.
We have to live. Eat something.
Right, you do. And but not just survive.
Why do we have to eat?
Human beings are entitled to a degree of health.
Wait a minute, let's get right to the core.
Human beings are entitled to a degree of health.
I'm getting hungry.
You know? And some human beings don't function well on purely vegetarian diets.
I know of a doctor
in Boulder.
I've been a vegetarian for 18 years.
He won't even treat women for infertility unless they're willing to eat red meat, because
that's
his experience.
I know doctors that won't treat women for infertility if they won't take a vegetarian diet.
Right. Okay, but this is the point. You know,
there's dozens of chiropractors.
Different human beings respond differently. Our bodies are not all the same, and what helps one body can be harmful to another body. Our metabolisms are different. Body chemistries are different.
How would you explain the high incidence of heart disease and cancer in America that doesn't exist in countries like India and Japan?
Mm-hmm.
That don't have a meat-centered diet.
I would say that one of the main reasons is look at the meat that we eat. Cows, fatty cows, game meat doesn't make nearly that. Look at the Eskimos. They eat the blubber, but they eat the cold water fish.
Mm.
You know, so
You know, I think that's a really silly kind of point to make.
I think it's silly.
I think we missed the boat here, because I don't think we set up the kind of ground rules that we should have here. I don't think we're, you know, what's the direction? Are we going to try to prove that that vegetarianism is something that everybody should do? Are we going to try to prove that there is a spiritual basis for vegetarianism? What's our focus here? I mean,
Well, my focus is beef, James. I'm an anomaly in this conversation, because having started out as eating just about anything my parents put on the table, I've gravitated towards pretty much a vegetarian diet. Although occasionally I'll eat a cheeseburger, or I'll have fish in a restaurant, or I don't eat big slabs of red meat anymore. I think Hal's right. The way you eat the meat has a great deal to do with the way your body deals with it. And I'm really affected by the arguments for the way veal is raised. I'll never eat veal again as long as it's raised the way it is. And the taste isn't that sensational that we can tolerate the cruelty to produce it.
You can get delicious range-fed veal at Michael's. It's fantastic. It's got some
avocado
and crab on top of it.
Something about eating a small calf turns my stomach anyway. But I just can't justify also the fact, you know, getting back to the argument about how much grain it takes to produce 1 pound of beef is legitimate to me. I mean, that's a fact. It takes X amount of grain to produce 1 pound of beef on the table. And when we have people starving in the world, when the final analysis, the energy that's going into that grain, into that beef, onto your table is subtracted from going to somewhere else like Bangladesh.
But, you know, I was a vegetarian for about 5 years. And I would go to relatives or friends' homes, and of course I wouldn't eat the meat. And there developed to be quite a fuss. What are we going to feed Hal? He's coming. Right? And, you know, after a while of looking at that situation, I really didn't see spirituality and goodness and kindness being promoted by that at all.
But eating meat does promote those things. Spirituality, goodness, kindness,
compassion.
No, what's
promoted is that when someone's offering me food for my sustenance, to take what they offer me, it will feed me and sustain me. And
so
I found
what if
that
I offered you human flesh?
I found that
what you said here, take this human flesh. It'll sustain you.
Yeah.
Chemically, it's not different from beef or chicken or lamb.
Right.
So eat human flesh. I think your logic is out to lunch. Actually, no matter how you cut it, that's a burger.
Well, the problem isn't
no matter how you cut it, it's all much more.
No matter how you cut it,
the problem obviously isn't. I don't think it's human flesh. You know, you bring up human flesh. Oh,
flesh
big
is
taboo.
Flesh.
You know,
flesh
big
is
T
flesh.
Taboo. That's right. It is.
So
flesh.
Eat flesh. Eat human flesh.
No, because killing a human being who has a spiritual endowment from God, I don't believe is appropriate. You know. It's just that simple.
Why?
It's not that it's unspiritual to eat human flesh, but
it's okay then.
Well, humans have done it. Yeah. There's no doubt about it. They've done it in the past, not just to survive, but as ritual.
Yeah, I think ritual was a big problem. Eating human flesh, because you're going to starve to death if you don't, and someone's already frozen to death anyways. Mm-hmm. I don't think that's any great sin.
No, but we could raise them, you know. I mean, they aborted all these babies. You know, why not just have the babies be born and be tender? You know, I mean, just don't throw them in the trash.
Because human beings receive a spiritual
endowment. It's a logical proposal.
You know,
there's so many babies that are coming. They're
going
to kill them anyway.
If we could prove that animals did, would you change your views? I mean, if you knew somehow in your heart that animals had a spiritual endowment from God that you don't somehow recognize now, would that change your mind about it?
Oh, sure it would.
Well, sure, how difficult, yeah. How much would you be willing, what sort of effort would you be willing to go to discover whether or not that exists?
Well, like I said, I've done two things that were very complementary.
Uh-huh.
One is my experience with reading the Urantia book provided me with a foundation of cosmology that I felt was really right on. It's very appealing to the mind. And also, when I looked out into the world and I see these animals being eaten alive, suffering and dying all the time, with no potential to get out of it, unlike human beings who do have great potential to get away and avoid suffering, I thought, God does not seem to care. This makes a lot of sense. You know, like I say, when the lion lies down with the lamb, I will stop eating and lamb.
Stop eating ham.
And ham. You know, whatever. That would be a good indication. That would change my belief instantly.
Okay.
Yeah.
Here's something that I would argue from the yogic tradition, and that is that as long as you are polluting your own consciousness field with the nervous systems and tissues of other conscious creatures, creatures that have evolved to the level of consciousness of an animal, okay, that your capacity to, to be clear, it's sort of like you've got a lot of extraneous vibrational matter or pollution in your energy field, in your consciousness.
Thank you very much for making the point. That's perfect. It just goes to me to demonstrate the validity to the notion that people who have these belief systems have trouble with forgiveness, because when you have trouble with forgiveness, arrogance and self-righteousness just pop right in there. I'm a high spiritual being because I recognize I will only eat the plants. Everyone else couldn't possibly be as spiritual as me, because look at that flesh that they're eating. You know, their consciousness has just been distorted. And
you lost me, Hal. That didn't follow somehow.
What are you missing? You just tried to make a point that the flesh itself, right, is going to pollute the consciousness, make it difficult to recognize true spiritual values, right?
That's what we're talking about.
Yeah.
And as a mediator, it seems...
Yeah, and that's what I say, very arrogant, you know? Very arrogant. My diet's more pure. I'm more pure. You know.
I'm not saying I'm more pure.
Yeah.
But
your spiritual perceptions are higher though because you don't eat meat. Your perceptions are not clouded by the fact that you
or the potentials the, are enhanced.
Right.
That
you
it's
eat
nonsense.
Meat.
But that's the thing is again we get back to authority and truth and. I mean, we can try and figure out the universe with our own puny endeavors and try and figure out what's right for us, or we can take knowledge from a higher source. And God being the supreme authority, it makes sense to me that we should accept his authority.
Well, why do pigs have such big muscle areas if they're not meant to be eaten?
Because they were bred that way by...
well, why did it turn out that way instead of, you know, selectively breeding them? Why didn't they get scrawnier and scrawnier?
A scrawny pig. Visit a factory farm.
Well, a lot of animals tend to have a lot of muscle mass.
Yeah,
that,
like
Albert
Schweitzinger.
Really good. Why does it taste Arnold. So good if we're not supposed to eat them? Is it just to test our strength?
Supposed to is such a strange question here. I don't know that it's really valuable for me to pursue the supposed to and the shoulds, but rather to look at what's available to me. What kind of choices do I have? And actually to try it and see. My experience is that my thoughts are clearer if I'm not eating meat. I'm probably healthier. I have less congestion in my breathing apparatus. And for me, when I don't eat eggs or dairy products, it's accentuated even further. I don't know if you've had experience with fasting ever, but once you get past about the third day, and you're no longer, you know, having to break down the chemistry of what you've been eating, there's a lot of energy that's freed up in your body to remember your dreams, to participate in them lucidly. The question that you asked, well, why do we eat at all? I think that's a valid question. I think that's something that we can address. And I think that there is a level of consciousness that's been demonstrated by some of the members of the species which doesn't take life from anywhere. I mean, they can sustain life from the vibrational field that God is.
I'll tell you a thought that'll change your dedication to eating meat forever, Hal. I have an occasion to witness occasional autopsies in my line of work, and one of the most astonishing things about people who eat meat is the amount of undigested meat in their intestines.
Really? Is that true?
Oh, yeah. It's the rankest, vilest substance you can ever imagine wafting up your nose at an autopsy. Now, may eat the meat, but it doesn't always leave your body.
Is it identifiable as undigested?
Oh, you think it's been there 20 years?
Oh, it's been there a long time.
Oh, come on. It takes a while to pass through me. It takes longer than some vegetables, but it's not sitting around there for 20
okay.
years.
The next time I go to an autopsy, I'll invite you along.
Okay.
If it's a meat eater. It's pretty disgusting.
That's why meat-eating animals like tigers and dogs and cats have a very short digestive tract.
Yeah, it just goes whoomp right through them.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Shorter
it's
than ours proportionally?
One-seventh the length of a human gut.
Yeah.
But,
well, there is an argument that, you know, we're omnivorous according to our dental, you know, construction.
I think that's a very good point.
Like pigs and bears, they can eat either, you know, a vegetable diet or a meat diet. You know, I don't presume to know, and I don't...
But you do have an indication, as you've just pointed out. Our teeth are well designed
but
to do either. Curious, isn't it? God, the great designer, happened to design us with teeth to do either one.
But he never gave you claws, and I would challenge you to take a sheep and kill it and eat it
but
with nothing but your fingers and your teeth.
But he did better than that. He gave us brain
tools,
to use tools.
Tools, absolutely.
If you didn't have any teeth at all, you could throw a beefsteak in a crock pot, and in 8 hours you could drink it. I mean, you don't need
but
teeth.
His argument was the bodily construction, not what we do with our hands, you know, whether we make a tool, but how the body is constructed. We're given two canine teeth, and that's a very flimsy argument to say, because I have two canine
teeth, I'm supposed to eat flesh. No problem.
As flimsy as the argument may be, here's one for everyone. We're starting to run out of time. And I'd like to invite the folks at home to get a hold of a pencil and some paper if they want to, because they can write in their opinions to Spiritual Spectrum, 2351 Ogden Street, Denver, Colorado. That's 80205. Or they can give us a call at area code 303-861-1186 and express their opinions. And we'd be glad to have you do that. If you have something that we've missed, or if you'd like to speak from an animal rights point of view, which we haven't heard specifically, please feel free to do so. Terry, take a couple minutes and you know, actually you got about a minute to kind of wrap this up.
Well, hey, I'm real curious as to whether Bill has been swayed one way or the other here today, or whether he's going to rush right out and get some tofu, or he's going to stop at Burger King on the way home.
I've got my tofu at home already. And I think that the arguments toward vegetarianism are very, very strong. But it's a matter of...
taste.
No. I just wish that I had a Seventh-day Adventist cook in my house. Because I've tasted
the
food.
They have a restaurant.
It's good.
Porter Hospital.
Well, guys,
yeah, right. It's wonderful.
I want to thank you all for your opinions. It's been a pleasure to participate in this. I'd like to thank you for joining in and being with us once again on Spiritual Spectrum. I hope you'll be back next time when, once again, we explore the newly emerging trends in the current religious scene. Thank you very much.